Okay, so this is the January call for Share Dev community. The first one of the new year, 2019. So welcome all. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
So as you can see, oh, let me put the link to the agenda in both the chat and Discord so folks have access to that. Okay, and then go ahead and add your names in, please, to the attendees. I'm just looking to see, do we have anyone new on the call that hasn't been on before? In the chat, make sure I have that open as well. Sounds like no. Okay. So, jumping right in. Anyone, doesn't have to be just one person, willing to jot in notes as we go?
I can do it.
Thank you, Cam. Okay. So the primary thing I wanted to start from today was looking at new project board that we just created yesterday. Day before yesterday, so not super long ago. Let me open that up. Okay, it is. Just let me do that. Great. So, I'm going to pause quickly so that I think everyone knows everyone's. We have that's on the call, Ryan. Usual suspects, Harsh, Cam, Jeff, et cetera. And Judy, I saw you're on the call as well.
I am. I can't get my video to work for some reason.
Okay.
Here I am.
Okay. All right. So what we have here is a slight improvement we hope from how things have been listed out, have issues tracked within here. So in the past we had one repo within Share Research that had its own GitHub project. So that was attached to this share and the repo, and it pretty much was primarily serving the, at least for the moment, serving the purpose of task tracking as a repo to have that. So instead we now have a project that's tied to the parent organization for all the repos. And let me get back to it. So now then it just has repos and within the organization linked to it. So any issues that are attached to those repos, they do show up here. So like we didn't actually migrate any of the existing issues to anything else. Just by linking the repos in, it was able to see all of the issues that have been that we've been tracking against to date. So the main thing that we've added since then is looking at how to attach some milestones to work against here. So not just at the granular task level, but also at one level above that. And these ones that are just here to start with certainly doesn't need to be the list forever, but can be tweaked. That what we have right now is initial suite of Share Red nodes, the build a metadata processing workflow, so things, the work that's been ongoing, then a single Share index instance running that can index data from a Share Red flow or multiple flows that can push to it. And then for the moment, having those instances be networked is a separate milestone. So two or more nodes can be networked together. So first, we can just focus on making sure we can have an index of things, and then those can share data with one another. Then the other two that are in here, a general reporting analysis dashboard that can display data from a share index, and then also the essentially the runtime environment. Actually, I think I'm going to change that wording now as we're talking. So I should write runtime environment for QMS and job. And just have that close. So anytime we define a flow, we don't want to be limited by, you know, a single client instance of ShareRed. We want to be able to have those be flows that then can be packaged up and executed. And there is some movement on that we're excited about. But any questions on this piece or comments before we move along? Let me make sure there's nothing in the chat as well. Okay, so I assume this all sounds good. One thing I was looking at that I think deserves some other opinions is how we would track associated subtasks to these things. I just added a couple examples in here. There's one, so within these organizational level projects, there isn't the notion of being able to set a milestone like there is for, if you're familiar with GitHub projects, at the repo level, you can set a milestone and then say, okay, these are all the issues that need to be done before the milestone is done. There isn't that notion at the organization level. There is, however, still the ability to attach labels to things so you can group things by a particular label. So I click that label and it just goes to that one ticket that's attached to it now. Something I noticed that Harsh had done in this issue actually was he had created a checklist and it looked like he was just doing it with Markdown. So that is another example that I added in here where I just replicated the formatting he was using to say, okay, this is our checklist. The downside to that is it is its own list that is, you know, not actually tied to any particular issue, so it won't automatically be checked when a related issue is done. But maybe we could also, if you add something, we could experiment if you actually like put in the URI or the URL to the issue, if it will show it as crossed out. I don't know if GitHub will do that or not when you finish it, but that would be something to experiment with. Any opinions on like how what you like or dislike about being able to track these subtasks?
I like the idea of using labels, but I don't know if you can do the same. Like, can you sync up labels across repositories?
So this one, for example, I think it is keeping the same label. When I added the label, I did add it through this level view. But that would be a good question.
Because if that is possible, then you can just on the organization level, you can just say filter by label and say label or filter by label sprint one, and then it will show you all the issues in all the different repositories with that label.
Yeah, it looks, because I'm looking at it not at the organization level, but at this level. And it looks like it does have that label intact. Like if I look at it here, so this is not the organization. Yeah, it looks like it does. It works at each nested level. Yeah, so that is useful. Yeah, it must be organization-wide when you add labels in here.
Yeah, that would be great. So the filter cards search dialog on the top over there, just above the in review column, you can just say label colon, whichever label you want to filter, and it'll show you all those cards.
Oh, can you attach one of these cards to it as well? I didn't look at that. But these things can be converted to issues as well. So it doesn't have to be limited by that. So that's probably an open question that we don't have to answer now. Yeah, so that would be something to add to the action item list. Just to investigate quickly about whether those labels can then be attached in that way. Attached to cards, was it? Yeah, it looked like it was pretty straightforward just to convert any one of these to an issue. I guess the question would be if it's converted to issue, it probably would then maybe want it to be tied to a particular repo, I'm guessing. Because these cards are just at this project level, as far as I can tell.
Yep.
Okay. Anything else on that point? Okay. So let's go back to the list. So that first one, the ShareRed runtime environment queuing. So that is something that Harsh, can you give an update on this one?
Sure. So I was working through the investigating if Node-RED can be used as a distributed fashion, if we can have like an engine running remotely and have flows running in those remote engines. So it seems like the community is and the core contributors are actively working on a new release. .20.0. And it was planned, the fact of that release was planned for early January, but it's because it's like a major re-architecture of the code base, restructuring of the code base. They are doing a different fashion of release and they're doing more beta releases. So just 2 hours back today, they released beta 3 and it seems like they're slightly delayed, but still very much on track to get the final release as soon as possible. There is no dates that is being mentioned anywhere as to when the final release will be there. But I would guess like by end of this month, more optimistically, maybe end of this month is when they would have a final release. There's, I think, 7 or 8 issues in the GitHub in their GitHub repository that they need to work through to be able to do a final release. I have documented some of my findings in two GitHub issues and where it talks more in detail about what is happening in the code, and some of that is a little bit of knowledge that maybe Ram and Ryan and Cam already know about, could be useful for others. So if you see any misinterpretation on my behalf or a missing piece of information, feel free to add over there. but what I was hoping through this exercise is to do some finding, bring it to the group and talk about it and say, okay, does this make sense for our needs? And so I've tried to put that in a little bit of words that I picked up from the Node-RED community about the 0.20 release, as well as in conversation with Jeff. So I am going to take that link and put it in the document. So it would be interesting to see what everybody else thinks about the use cases that have been put up in the Node-RED Node-RED design for 0.20, and if those fit our needs partially or completely is yet to be identified. But from my standpoint, I feel like this is a very promising release, and we should wait for the final release of 0.20 and see how far that can get us in terms of what we want to do at with ShareRed.
I just found the link that you'd shared the other day about what the differences are for this release. So it and just by their like high level description, it didn't make sense to me until I looked at these specific use cases. So like the one that seems to map the best to us is this what scaled one that we had talked about. So a Node-RED flow is that in one place, when deployed, it gets sent to multiple runtimes to provide horizontal scaling, custom action added behind the deploy, et cetera. And then also like the distributed gets carved into different parts, puts different runtimes, either local or remote. So this is then theoretically possible to have things that operate more as a server versus a client that is an editor that kind of has everything wrapped up with it. So that is the, so that's the core of it is splitting all of these things up into multiple parts.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Like just being able to not want the runtime when you're editing it and not and vice versa, like not have the editor when you're just running a flow is what makes it a little bit easier to wrap in our head saying, yeah, this is client, this is server. And it also makes it very lightweight. I know in this release, they're doing more upgrades and minor adding more buttons on the UI to make it easier to do like collaborative workflow development. And they already have the projects feature in Node-RED. So I think we're already doing that in ShareRed, but now with this release, they are adding more easier navigation capabilities on the editor itself. In that model, on a specific flow, it becomes much more easier to use one UI, one editor to do shared development for the flow and then deploy it to a remote cluster of engines.
Yeah, so also to give more background, so part of the question that before we'd heard that this was just going to be released, I was wondering whether we would need to create some kind of interim solution, kind of assuming that this is the best long-term path, but in order to keep moving ourselves. So it sounds like, so like from your standpoint, Harsh, does it seem like this is moving fast enough for us to?
Yeah, timeline-wise, I think this is moving fast enough, and I think the community is large enough to keep it moving forward, and it's still very active. And so we want to keep a tab on, like, are people continuing to use Node-RED in the future? If that is something which changes, then it puts the maintainability of this kind of an open source application into question, and its stability into question. There are, in terms of like long-term feasibility of using Node-RED itself, I think there are other questions we need to answer is, does it fit our needs first? And that would mean like in, once we have the final release, we start playing around, fleshing out all the use cases, have a cluster of engines and do like sessions to just go through the motions of building a workflow, deploying it, seeing the changes, again, building it again, and finding out what works and what doesn't work for us. The second piece of this is like also to understand and make sure how are we going to maintain the infrastructure and how are we going to do the deployment and maintenance of that if we are using like a shared cluster. And that is more like a question for us internally amongst the share research contributors as to how we want to do this and who takes ownership of that. But those are the questions I think we should be able to answer like once we get into doing more with the latest release of Node-RED.
Okay. That's great. Any additional comments or questions? Okay. All right. So then the next thing, so again, looking at our list here. Oh, that was the wrong one. Here we go. So the So the assessment here in terms of like order of priority of when we can work on these things was that we should, the initial guess was that we should continue to focus on this initial suite of shared nodes. So again, this was just the stab I took at trying to start seed that list of tasks. But listing the initial set of share nodes, I think that's where we want to get to. Because at the moment, like what the flows we've created to date with the nodes that are custom to that, I would still consider those, you know, not very, very much pre-release in terms of robustness, et cetera. So the next step is then to start generating that list of, okay, these are the nodes that we want to have in our toolkit that then for common operations that we then just want to have available as someone is looking to build a new flow. And this one, Jeff, we can talk about later. This actually came up in a PressQT grant related meeting this morning as a potential use of this, where it was actually a really natural fit in terms of looking to map metadata from one source repository to a target repository.
Good.
So I think that there may be some clear alignment there that we had not thought about yet.
Great.
Okay. So looking at this initial list then, I had promised that I would start to see this, but I didn't get to it yet, so I will start now. I will own that. So the one that I think the one obvious one is parsing names is one. There are others like it. I think as we've gone through the working through the different use cases, there have been a few different common operations that have emerged. Another one is branching on multiple fields and wrapping up in single object. That's pretty verbose, but can of course be updated. Go. And oh wait, I thought I had this open still. Maybe it's not open anymore. Okay. Anything anyone else can think of that we should start adding here? Jeff, sounded like you had.
Yeah. Let's see. OAI PMH seems like an obvious node.
Mm-hmm.
Do we still want to do gender analysis as a possibility?
What's that?
Do we still want to do gender analysis as a possibility? It wouldn't be that robust, just because. I mean, we could make a robust one, I guess.
Well, would that be a flow or like example flow or example node?
That'd be an example node.
Gender analysis. Okay. Let's see, there were some others like load metadata mapping was another one that was already starting to wrap up into nodes in the flow I was looking at. Load CSV data is another one. Maybe this is a good enough list to start with for now.
Yeah, I think that's fine.
Yeah, so then the idea here is we would then create issues for each of these, and we can divvy up the implementation. And of course, I would imagine that we will go through many different iterations of these as we go. But one thing we hadn't, I don't know that we had talked explicitly about was how we would manage the versioning or release of individual nodes, or like, does it probably make sense to have those just be wrapped up in a release of the suite of nodes in general? Does that make sense? I'm assuming silence is agreement.
Can you go into that a little deeper?
So theoretically, you know, as we're working through these, someone could say, okay, I'm making this node, and it is it's its own atomic object that has its own versioning and release schedule and all those things. Or we could have more of the share library itself have its own versioning and release, that as a node is added, you know, that would be a new version, or node or nodes are added.
I see. I think for it to be congruent with the node red way of doing things, each would have its probably own versioning.
We could do that as a mono repo, right?
We could do a mono repo. We should think about this one though, because this one seems like one that we'd get many contributions from different people in the future, and they would maybe even want their own recognition for that. Mm-hmm. So a mono repo might make sense.
Yeah, but I guess like the
individual repos could, I think we can think through that one, but yeah. I think they should each have their own versioning issues and whatnot.
So that would be another action item then. Versioning of individual nodes versus common share suite release.
So is the idea that these custom nodes would like sit outside of the share red repository?
They would.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah, but certainly in terms of like the, I would think for the mono repo, maybe that is as simple as just being pre-configured to have a certain set of nodes already loaded in.
Well, this is where I think we need to, and Ryan can comment on this, but I think about how we can have a default menu. I think in the node red GUI, there's off to the left, there's a panel of nodes. And I believe Ryan has looked into adding our own category. And I think it's based on tagging. And so we would tag certain repos or use tags or the organization itself, the share research organization, and load those packages in to the GUI that way. So it doesn't have to come from us specifically, but we can tag things marked as share research, or we can tag things marked as share in NPM, which is the JavaScript package management system, as being relevant to share node red. And then those things would automatically show up by default in share red. Ryan, can you comment on that?
Yeah, so that's all very doable in Node-RED, Share-RED. We actually already have it working right now where we can categorize everything within the share category on the left-hand side. And adding a tagging system like you were talking about, Jeff, would be completely doable.
How is it done now? Is it hard-coded as to what packages go in there?
Into the share section?
Yeah.
Each individual node, when you create it, you specify which category it goes into.
Okay, so if I was a package developer or maintainer on NPM, is there a way for me to get into that category, or are you automatically, how are you getting those things into share red right now?
Here, I'm gonna send a picture right now, one sec. Pretty much when you create the node itself, you add the category share, and it'll, if that category is there, automatically there, it'll automatically put it there. So
So ShareRed would then just need to include in the package.json whatever nodes that we want to include in that category, and then those nodes need to have the category specified as share.
Correct. Yes. Okay. And since the category share is completely made up by however many nodes are there, so if they entered share whatever name, it would make a new category for that. So share is the category, and it will be added to it.
Okay. So then on the back of end of this, it doesn't matter at all how we organize the repos. So what? Okay. So then one more question would be. So that interface we can develop out very easily with how we ship ShareRed. ShareRed would have a default set of nodes that it would install. Those nodes would then basically self-declare themselves to the share category. So now for nodes that we don't include, but maybe people don't want them included by default, or we don't want them included by default because we're really giving them some credibility. Some indications of oversight or code review or whatever. Can we change the default search interface to include things like tags in NPM or certain repos or whatnot? When you can install from Node-RED, I think there's that goes on the right side. I can search and then install nodes. Is that right?
Yep, you can search for any nodes that are share nodes in the search engine that's built into Share, Node-RED, sorry. And we can all have them in a category of Share, and then all those with that category would come up when you search for it.
Okay, and that's an NPM thing then?
It's built into the Node-RED, into Node-RED.
Okay, but the data comes from NPM?
I believe so. I can double check that for you though.
Okay. So that then speaks to having a community standard for things developed specifically for ShareRed, and how people, the metadata that they add to their packages that they develop.
Right.
Yeah, so that sounds to me like we should have a quick write-up of how you create a ShareRed node with an example. So there is already this ticket share 15 to create that first node, or at least to have an example. It doesn't have to be the first node. So it sounds like we just need an additional task here.
So let's create a repo under share research called share-red-node-example.
Okay. And then we could just have a github.io page for that or something.
I think we can just create a package and people, that would be the one that we encourage people to fork as they develop their own packages.
Okay, and then just have its own readme or something.
Yep, I can have a readme and all of the training information there, but that's the one that we'll keep up to date as far as how we encourage people to tag their packages.
So looks like it wants me to create a note first and then convert to an issue. So that would be create ShareRed node example repo. I'll just put this on ShareRed for now. Okay. And just creating the repo. Cam or Ryan, could you do that? Cam, you're nodding. Can you take that one?
Yeah, go ahead and do that.
I keep forgetting I'm muted when I talk.
Let's see, can I not assign in this screen? Okay, assign. There we go. Okay. And I can probably attach myself as well just to look at the initial set, because I, even if it's just doing the first fork of that. Yeah, so I think, yeah, I think that sounds good to me to wait for Cam, for you to create that first, and then I can work on doing a fork of that. That is one more of this in this list of nodes that we have in the agenda here. So picking one of those.
Sounds good.
And then we can send out the notes of the list, and then it feels much more actionable to me that then we can say, let's have someone take one of these. Okay, anything else on this one? I think the only other thing I could think of here is like timing, and maybe table that until the next call date that's currently set for February. But we don't necessarily need to have to wait until February to have our next call. I think, is anyone interested in hearing some of the recap of the CNI presentation we did? I think many folks on the call were actually there. Maybe Leo and Matt, you were not, and Harsh, but everyone else was there.
I guess I'm curious, like, what in what context? Like, I know there was a presentation about share research over there, and if that presentation or any other connections and discussions with people over there in that conference have influenced influenced our sharing.
I don't know that there has been a whole lot yet. We kind of laid it out as an open invitation to try to connect with people or organizations that would be interested in contributing, but also to let them know there's kind of multiple points in time that they could engage, whether as a development partner, new development partner, or as an adopter, et cetera. So like we wanted to at least like communicate the work that's happening and then what's coming next and the timing there. Sure. And I think I do actually have this. These were the slides that we went through. Just kind of went through the overall strategy, use case Notre Dame, talked about their the community, so like monthly calls, ramping conditional developers. Then, you know, focusing on the core technology. And then talked about a bit about, and these are like high level abstraction diagrams, right? But like looking at, here's a flow and looking at the source, et cetera. And we did show like some example flows as well, but that was the bulk of it.
Okay.
And then there was the other share related presentation that was around the NEH, the National Endowment for Humanities grant, that is around surfacing digital humanities projects better, making those more accessible. And were there any strong takeaways from that, Jeff or Judy?
I think there was, this is Judy, obviously. I think there was great enthusiasm for looking at what can be done with linked funding data, project data related to funding. So the presentation contained just great work around, distribution of funds by the NEH to institutions, by gender of the investigator, just all kinds of interesting things that can be done if there's, and then, whether there were DOIs or whether URLs resolved at all, and just all kinds of, it was a super interesting, and I think people connected to it as, I heard people talking about it afterwards as, something that would be just nice to have for any number of funders.
Yeah, Ryan and Cam did a nice job of putting together some interesting analyses and graphs that we showed. Judy, maybe we can link to the presentation in the notes.
Yeah, that's a great idea, and we should put it on the Share website if it isn't already. So
yeah, we'll drop the
maybe write a little item about it or something. That's a great idea.
Good. Yeah, and actually, along those lines, I noticed that the other presentation, Cam and Ryan, it's the permissions are set so that it is not, there isn't like a public viewable link to it.
I'll fix that.
Fix that as well.
Sure.
Okay, any questions, comments on those?
No, thank you.
All right. So looking at the next call, February, like looking at the list of things we have here, waiting 4 weeks to talk again with this group feels too long to me. I don't know if others have the same sense. I saw nods. So
maybe
go ahead.
Maybe we can open up one of our developer meetings or publicize one of our developer meetings to the mailing list and whatnot. And then people could join that if they'd like to in like 2 weeks.
Yeah, that sounds good. So to give more background, so we've had some smaller discussions, just myself, Jeff, Cam, and Ryan and Harsh as a smaller group working through some of this. And we've been doing those Friday mornings. So if we say, let's see, so like January 25th, maybe, and it's been at 11 a.m. Eastern, so 8 a.m. Pacific time has been when we've been doing those. So that feels good to me. So like if we look to have, to push through these two ones before that, I think that seems like a good objective to have there. So like if we're looking to have a share red note example, however, complex it may be or simple it may be, have that be done by 2 weeks from tomorrow. And then we could have that be open. Does that seem reasonable, Cam, Ryan?
Yeah.
So, or Cam, that's your task, I guess. And I think it's reasonable for me to look at that as well.
Yeah, definitely.
And we could potentially have more than one example, right? So.
Great. Yeah, I'm sure we could pump out a few.
Is there anything with the Share Red runtime environment to do? Harsh, I know you had this Understand Code current Node-RED architecture in your queue still.
Yeah, so what I was hoping to do with that is probably try taking the current branch of 0.20 beta that was released today and see what it takes to merge it into our Share Red fork. Because I know like some of the work that we talked about today about creating custom nodes and so where that lives in the new code base might change. And I don't know how it will complicate things or it will simplify things. So that's worth a discussion to have sooner rather than later, because we do definitely intend to go down that path. So maybe on the share dev call tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern time, maybe we can talk a little bit more about that.
Okay.
And honestly, I could definitely use help from Cam or Ryan to do the merging and make sure we're doing the right thing over there.
If you'd get a chance to try to update the share red to, what was it, .20?
.20 beta 3.
Yeah, so if you could try to update that before the call, then we could do a little bit of debugging on the call.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, and then, and that seems that this one is share 21. Is that basically done then, Harsh?
Yeah. I just wanted to keep it in review so that others get a chance to like add comments or ask questions.
Okay.
But if there's nothing, we can just move it to done, both of them actually.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like this is a new task issue.
Yeah.
So yeah, so if you can add that.
Sure, I'll add that, yeah.
Perfect. Okay, well, I think that, so for now we'll keep the, so we'll have, actually, let's put make sure that's in the notes. So, next time call. So let's add in here some sub bullets here. So dev call February 25 time. And there is a different Zoom link for that, so we can send that out. We can send that to the share dev list and the Discord channel when ready, but that, and then regular commit recall. Okay. All right, well, we can adjourn about 10 minutes early here. Anything else? Okay.
Did we grab all the links that have been put in the chat?
Oh, yeah. Yes, good idea. That is not going to be retained. Looks like it's just the agenda that's been in there so far.
Okay, good. Yeah, I just saw that too. Okay, great.
Yep. Yes, thank you for calling that out.
Okay, thanks.
All right, and as usual, we'll get this recording pushed up so that can be available for others to watch later on. Mm-hmm. And I think the November call, we didn't do recording for December because it was very small numbers, but the November one I think is still pending to get pushed up to YouTube, so I'll look at both of those.
Good.
I'll look at those tomorrow because it usually takes about 3 or 4 hours sometimes for the recordings to come through for this one. All right. Well, thank you all for joining. I am continually more and more excited as we keep going.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Rick. Thanks, all.
Later, guys.
Bye-bye.